Welcome back. So, in this session we are going to discuss another very, very important area of logistics. I won't still call it a supply chain management area, because transportation is something which is specific to a particular organization, to a particular company, and proper transportation management ensures a company can save a lot of money, because there are a lot of expenses on transportation. A proper transportation can also ensure proper customer service for a particular company. So, what are the various areas in transportation that we are going to discuss? We are actually going to discuss transportation and distribution. Now, we are not going to discuss single mode of transportation. So, we are going to discuss the various modes. Primarily, in our day to day study or in our day to day life, we primarily talk of road, rail, air and sea. Of course, there is another one, which is pipeline. So, I need not tell you what road transportation is all about: railways, by air, by ocean, pipeline, oil, gas, etcetera, which are moved through pipeline mode of transportation. We are going to discuss the various cost factors. We are going to discuss the service factors. Different distribution channels, also we are going to discuss a little bit of what fleet management is. So, again we have our PowerPoint presentation. Will primarily we will follow the presentation, and in between I will try to explain the topic, and we will come back to the board for a detailed explanation. So, let us go back to the PowerPoint presentation. So, if you see, we are talking of primarily this presentation, of course, is something which is not made in India. So, the prices are in terms of US dollars and the weight are in terms of pounds, does not matter. What it says is that there are basically, we will not talk of rail intermodal and rail car load or rail unit, we will take rail as an individual, as a whole. So, we are talking of four varieties or four modes of transportation. From left to right, air cargo or air freight, then roadways, that is truck, and then we are talking of water, that means ocean transport. Okay. Air, truck, rail and water. Now, if you go from right to left, and if you see the cost per unit, the cost per unit weight increases the moment we move from water to railways to truck and then to cargo. So, there are two factors that we have to see, as I have just shown it on the board. One is the cost factor and one is the service factor. Whereas, the cost is higher from right to left, air cargo or truck is definitely the fastest, more visible, reliable. It can carry the lowest weight, it can carry the highest value and the most time sensitive. Rail generally is still fast, reliable, it's competitive over truck. When we say waterways, it is relatively slower, obviously, the transit time is much more. Less reliable, less visible, when we say visible, it is very difficult to track. It is very difficult to track a shipment which is moving by sea. But it can carry the highest weight possible through containers. It carries items which are very low in volume and very low, very less time sensitive. So, basically this particular slides gives us a comparative analysis between the four modes of transportation, that is air, road, rail and ocean or water, and it gives us a comparative analysis of the cost as well as the service parameters. Let's go to the next slide. These are the factors which affect or influence transportation: the geography, the distance, accessibility of a particular area. When you get the study material, you will see for yourself. On the left hand side, we have mentioned the conditions which affect transportation. Basically, there are 7 of them: geography, the type of product that is carried, the economies of scale that a particular transport mode provides, the trade imbalance between two locations, between which, when I say trade imbalance, that means you are carrying a material or a shipment from one place which is potentially very developed to a place which is not potentially developed. That means there's a possibility of an empty travel from one place to the other. Then you have the infrastructure, whether you have proper roadways, whether you have proper roads, whether you have proper railways, whether it is well connected, whether you have the right kind of ports and terminals, the mode, and then the competition and regulations. So, these are the conditions which affect transportation, and we have also given, if you see the mode, the capacity limitations, operational condition, a bus compared to a car. So, we have just given between two modes of transportation, what is the difference between a capacity. Obviously, the capacity of a bus is much more compared to a, in economies of scale, we are talking of shipment size. We go to the next slide. This particular session will be covered mostly by slides through the PowerPoint presentation. I will go a little slow for you to understand. Cost is a huge factor in transportation. As I said, warehousing and transportation are the two most important area in logistics, because both of them consumes a lot of cost, a lot of money is spent on both these services. So, as for transportation is concerned, there are 6 factors which influence the cost of transportation. Obviously, the distance, more the distance, more the cost, more the volume, more the cost, but we will see at a later stage that the cost per unit may not rise with volume or density or distance. Cost per unit, cost per unit weight, cost per unit volume. Here we are talking of absolute cost, the total cost, stowability, handling, liability. We have all heard of distance, we have all heard of volume, we have all heard of density. I do not know how many of you have heard of stowability. Stowability is the storing or the capacity of a particular item being stored in a container. I will give you an example. You take a jar, and I give you 2 examples. One is stone and one is sugar. You try to, sugar has far better stability, or take coal. So, you take a big glass jar and you put sugar inside, you can accommodate the maximum amount of sugar. If you take coal, which are ununiform in size, it will have lot of gaps when you put that inside, or something which is ununiform. Similarly, in a container, when you put equal size cartons or boxes in a container, you will find them fitting in the container perfectly. Without any gap in between. But you try to accommodate something like some bulk item like rocks, you will find lot of gaps. You will find lot of gaps in between. So obviously, this has a far better stability than items which are non-uniform in size. So the cost also differs. So probably, when we talk of the same volume or weight of item, items which has better stability can be accommodated in a single container. Item of this a different item which has bad stability, the same volume of item or the same weight of item may require two containers to accommodate, right? Handling, obviously heavy items, items which are not similar in size or shape or the dimensions are different, which needs better handling, more labor, more material equipment, handling equipments, obviously will incur additional cost. Liability, what is liability? Liability means insurance. Expensive items, items which are high in volume or high in value, something happens, some damage happens, you need to pay a lot of money, a lot of there is a lot of claim. So when you insure items which are high in value, you need to pay very high insurance premium, which is also a part of the cost. But items which are of low value obviously do not attract too much of insurance being paid or claims being settled. So we will go to the next slide. The next slide gives you few slides will give you some graphical representation between distance and cost. On the x axis you have the distance, on the y axis you have the cost. So initially, with distance, the price per unit. So more the distance, the price per unit increases. But when in distance increases, then the price per unit comes down. This will be very well explained in this particular next diagram. In this diagram, C1 denotes, listen to me very carefully. So the blue area, there are three distances that has been taken, 0 to D1, D1 to D2 and D2 to D3. Okay. Now, if you see, it is economical for a shorter distance to use road transport, for a little higher distance, and is it will always happen like that, for a little higher distance it is always economical or it is always advisable to use railways as the transportation mode, and for long, very long distances, in fact between two countries, when shipment moves from two countries, it is always advisable to use maritime or the ocean transport. If you see, if you go to any particular block, whether it is the blue or the yellow or the green, and if you see the transportation cost per unit for the roadways is minimum in the blue area, transportation cost per unit is relatively lower in the blue, in the yellow section. And when you, there is a reason, when companies send bulk items and when they do exports, when they are sending shipments in thousands and thousands of kilometers through by ocean, they obviously will not use either air or roadways or whatever it may be. They use, generally they use the maritime or the or sea. So this particular diagram very clearly gives you a comparative study of cost per unit cost for between any two distance, if you the relative cost between three modes of transport, that is road, रेल एंड मैरिटाइम. ओके, इफ यू ड्रॉ अ लाइन, जस्ट टेक द ग्रीन पोर्शन एंड इफ यू टेक एनी पॉइंट एंड इफ यू ड्रॉ अ वर्टिकल लाइन, यू विल फाइंड द कॉस्ट इन मैरिटाइम विच इज C3 इज मिनिमम, वेर एज द अदर कॉस्ट इट विल बी मोर बाय रेलवेज एंड इट विल बी मच मोर बाय रोड. सो दिस इज द कंपेरेटिव स्टडी. द वॉल्यूम ऑल्सो हैज द सेम थिंग. नाउ लेट मी टेल यू ऑन वॉल्यूम, देयर इज समथिंग वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इन ट्रांसपोर्टेशन एज फार वॉल्यूम इज कंसर्न्ड. इट इज नॉट नेसेसरी इफ यू टेक अ बैग ऑफ कॉटन एंड इफ यू बुक इट थ्रू एन एयरलाइंस फॉर इंस्टेंस, ओके, दे विल नॉट कंसिडर द एक्चुअल वेट. वॉट दे डू इज दैट कैरियर्स, पर्टिकुलरली एयर कैरियर्स, दे कंसिडर वॉट इज कॉल्ड डायमेंशनल वेट. So there is a formula. So if you take a bag of cotton and if you, for example, if you take the actual weight of that particular bag, it may be 50 kilos. But you have to see what the airlines do or what the carrier does is that they consider the space that this particular bag would occupy in the cargo hold. So they apply that formula. Length into breadth into height divided by 6000, or it depends upon whether you are taking, whether it is 6000 or 1728, whether. So this is a little technical. Rather than doing this, I would say actual weight or volumetric weight, whichever is higher. So when they take the volumetric weight, you may find the volumetric weight by applying that particular formula, dimensional weight formula, it may be 75 kilos. So let's go to that diagram, that graphical that graph, which says cost per ton or cost per unit as and when the volume increase or the weight of the shipment increases, the cost per ton it reduces. That is what is applied. Same with the density. I think you all know what the density. Shipment which has more volume has lesser density and vice versa. So the density, the relationship between density and cost is almost the same like volume and the actual weight of a shipment. So the factors driving the cost, as I mentioned, stability, how dimension can be positioned, handling, loading and unloading, liability characteristics that can result in damage and then can attract claims, insurance claims. So transportation cost depends upon the product itself as well as the market. That means when I say market, where it is being shipped, from where it is shipped to where it is shipped. As far as the product itself is concerned, we have just discussed density, stability, handling, liability, etc. When it comes to market, we are talking of intramode and intermode competition, where the market is located, what are the regulations in the market, balance, imbalance of freight traffic. For instance, when you take a shipment from say Delhi to a place in Northeast. Now there is a trade imbalance. What is imbalance? So the flow of shipment is quite high from Delhi or from Mumbai, but there is a possibility that there are some upcoming markets, there are places where the trade or the business may not be that high. So the possibility of a return shipment from that particular place may be low. So the transportation cost. So if you ask a transporter, the cost of moving a shipment from a place with high trade opportunities to a low trade area, they may ask a higher price, because he knows that there is a possibility of not getting a load back to his origin, which is Mumbai or Delhi or whatever it may be. But if the same load is being moved from a place where the where there is a lot of volume in terms of shipment to another place, suppose the shipment is moving from Mumbai to Chennai or Mumbai to Delhi, so the transporter is confident that I will have a reverse load as well. So he might charge a lesser price, or he may charge a lesser rate per unit. Today transporters also charge per unit distance, per kilometer maybe. Then the seasonality of product movement, it depends. If you see, this is the season for mangoes. So it depends upon a particular seasonal product, how high demand that particular product, from where it is going from to which place is it going. So these are market related costs, transportation costs. So one side it is product related, the other side it is market related. These are the two areas on which transport costs depend upon. We will go to the next slide. So obviously there are variable costs which vary with fuel, labor, maintenance, handling, pickup, delivery, fixed cost, the facilities, the equipment, administering the vehicles, joint costs which are shared, common costs are shared cost between maybe two partners who are sharing the shipment or who are involved in moving a particular shipment in two places. So sometimes they might share a particular terminal cost, for instance. So these are the different types of costs: variable, fixed, joint, as well as. Now if you see the backhaul move, hand in hand cost, joint cost, that means as I just said, there is a possibility that when I am moving a shipment from a place where the trade or the volume of trade is high to a place where the volume of trade is low, that means the backhaul, that means the return journey, there is a possibility that he may not get a shipment. So there may be a cost which may be shared. Okay. We are not going to discuss all the slides, as I said. We are only going to discuss the slides which are relevant to us. So fixed and operating transportation costs. In the previous slides, we had seen there are two types of costs: fixed and transport. How they vary? How do we compare this fixed and operating transport cost between four modes of transportation? Rail or highway, we keep rail and highway as one of the modes, we take pipeline as another mode, we take air as another mode, and we take ocean or maritime as another mode. So we see how this cost vary. Let us take one by one. So when we talk of rail and highway, what are these fixed costs come from? The fixed costs come from the land construction, the railway tracks. And what are the operating costs for rail or highway? Maintenance cost, labor cost, fuel cost. If you see the airways, I'm not trying to touch all the modes of transport, just few of them for you to understand. If you take air as the mode of transport, so what are the fixed costs which are related to air freight or air mode of transport? It is the land, the terminal, the airport, the construction, the aircraft itself is a cost. Again, what are the operating costs? Maintaining the aircrafts, maintaining the terminals, the fuels which are required to fly the aircrafts. Same with maritime. If it is airport, if the fixed cost for air is airport, then the fixed cost for ocean is obviously the ports and the terminals, the ships, the equipments. Maintenance, labor and fuel almost are common variable operating cost for all the modes of transport. Fixed and variable cost and services in transportation system. What does this tell you? If you see the fixed infrastructure, ownership, it is mostly public and variable costs are mostly private. What are we trying to say? Who owns a particular port? It belongs to the, generally it is belongs to the government. So, all the costs which are related, all the fixed cost, they are public cost, and the maintenance cost, they are private cost, mostly private. Let us go and see the others. The lifespan, the fixed infrastructure, once you build a port, once you build an airport, it is very long. You do not change or shift airports and ports every now and then. Whereas, when it comes to variable cost, it changes quite frequently. You can change labor, you can change the maintenance costs, you can change the service partners, whatever it is. Same with ownership, as I said, examples. When I say fixed infrastructure, where does the fixed infrastructure come from? It comes from the highways, it comes from the rail tracks, airports, ports, and the variable truck comes from the trucks, rail cars, planes, and ships. So, these are the maintenance variable costs are coming from the vehicles themselves. So, this particular slide actually tells you about the characteristics between the fixed and the variable cost. This is something we have discussed. Ancillary value added services. In transportation, it is extremely important today to understand what is an ancillary cost. Now, you will find, if you see the first one, COD, we have all heard of COD, collect payment on delivery. Sometimes a service provider may ask additional cost if the payment against the particular product to be delivered is to be collected from the customer, because there is a risk involved. Similarly, delivery out of office hours, delivery at two different places, delivery after sorting, or keeping in storage before delivery. So, what is ancillary? Ancillary means extra, additional cost. So, there are a lot of additional cost today, particularly today, which are, today we find that there are additional cost, people are charging additional cost for extra delivery. If you go to today in our country, today we have been very flexible. If you go overseas and if you expect a carrier to re-attempt a delivery, suppose the service provider came and tried delivery on Monday morning at 10 o'clock when there was nobody at house, they would take the shipment back. If you request the service provider to deliver it once again, they will charge you X dollars or X pounds or X whatever it may be. That practice is there with many service provider, very reputed service provider in our country today. They would charge additional amount for. Suppose the delivery has come to your place and you suddenly realize that the shipment is not to be delivered in your residence, but to your office, which is 5 kilometers away, there would be an ancillary cost, there may be an additional cost. So, we have to remember, when we become a logistic service provider, earlier, and that is the reason why logistics and supply chain management is being studied, because of the cost factors, certain cost factors which were never considered important earlier. I have worked with companies where we have re-attempted delivery without any cost, where we have delivered again, we have brought the shipment back, heavy bulk shipment back to our warehouse, because the customer was not ready to receive the shipment, because the shipment arrived a little late. So, the customer is expecting us to go back and deliver the shipment the next day morning. Where the customer wanted the shipment to be retained in our warehouse because he was not ready to receive the shipment. Today, all these benefits, customers, strong customers who have enough business volumes, to transport companies, logistics company, they tailor make their transportation system. So they have lot of godowns, warehouses, distribution centers from where shipments are to be picked up, to be delivered to the retailers, to the distributors, to the wholesalers, or maybe directly to the customers, and the volumes are very high, and the customers have certain requirements themselves. So transporters, they do not apply their own standard services, they design a product. The design, as you have seen, this is applicable to not only to transportation, to many other services and products. Service providers are ready to redesign their services depending upon how important the customer is to that particular service provider. So there is a lot of tailor-made transportations which are tailored transportation available. One very important factor in transportation is routing. This is again was not studied earlier. Today routing, that means how to route your vehicle, how to use the best path, for two reasons. One is for faster delivery, two for cost reduction. This is how efficiency is attained in logistics. So routing management today is again becoming very, very important, and there is a lot of technology is applied to understand how to do a better routing, because of things like GPS, because of RFID and etcetera, etcetera. Our shipments, our vehicles, the movement of our shipments are visible to us. We can see how they are moving. We can record the entire movement of our vehicles. We can record the entire movement of all the shipments. And we will know ultimately whether the route followed by our vehicles or our transporters or our logistic service providers are best or not. We can analyze, we can correct ourselves. So routing is an extremely important factor in transportation management. Let's see the next slides. So this basically tells you how to ensure a good routing. Load trucks with deliveries for customers close to each other, stop on individual days, start routing with farthest stop first. Circular routes, don't cross paths, use largest vehicles first, mix pickups, stop from other, avoid narrow stop windows, etcetera, etcetera. So these are the techniques that a company or a logistics department who's managing transportation, they use to ensure that they execute the best routing system. So there is basically, when we say transportation management, there are four areas of management of transportation: fleet management, freight consolidation, rate negotiation, and freight control. When I say fleet management, I'm talking of the vehicles. Companies who operate their own logistics, companies who have their own transporters, they do a fleet management, whereas companies who hire other transporters, they also need to do a fleet management jointly between the transport company as well as the company themselves. Consolidate freight to ensure they don't use too many vehicles, they don't use too many routes, they consolidate. We just saw in warehouse management also consolidation. So a transporter moving at a particular distance or a particular route would consolidate all shipments which are meant for that particular route, so that they can deliver shipments in that particular route rather than using many vehicles, multiple vehicles. Rate negotiation extremely important. As I said, transportation is huge, transportation cost is huge. It's extremely important for logistics manager, transportation manager to have proper rates, freight rates, transportation rates from there. Next we come to distribution. Now what is the difference between transportation and distribution? If you remember yesterday, we touched this point very briefly. Transportation is the mode by which shipments are delivered. Now basically, you have a company here who's producing a particular product. On the other side, you have the customer. So there is a product which is manufactured by the company, and it has to ultimately reach the customer. How this should reach? Now, there is, we are not talking of one customer, we are talking of multiple customers. There is a network of customers, there are number of customers. Today, there are companies who operate, who have a large network of dealers, they have large network of retailers, they have large network of consumers. Consumer goods, their consumers are spread. When we talk of multinational, think of Unilever, think of Procter and Gamble. Within our country, think of ITC, think of Patanjali, think of Nestle globally. See the network they are operating into. So, everybody, depending upon the product that they produce or they manufacture, they use different ways to distribute their product from the company to the customer. And what are they? We are going to just discuss. Let us refer to the slide. So, what is distribution? Distribution are the steps taken to move and store a product from the supplier stage to the customer. Distribution directly affects cost. Customer, it also affects customer experience, and a properly managed distribution can ensure profitability for a company. The choice of distribution network can achieve supply chain objectives from low cost to high responsiveness. Companies like Walmart, Dell, Procter & Gamble, Grainger, these companies, as you all know, they are computer manufacturer or in retail business, whoever it is, they follow, they execute a very, very efficient system of distribution. We are going to discuss now in the next few slides what are the different types of distribution. Let us not try to understand the distribution in detail, as well, long as we know what are the different types. Basically, there are three more entities involved in this distribution. Who are they? One is a distributor, you have a retailer, and you have a carrier. So, between a company and a customer, these are the three entities who play a vital role in distribution. How companies utilize all three of them or don't utilize them at all is what we are going to study in the next few slides. So, let's go back to a slide. So, distribution network performs customer needs that are met. Why do we need to do study distribution management? Because proper distribution would ensure customer satisfaction, it will reduce our cost, so what are the factors that influence distribution network design? On one side you have response time, the variety of product that a customer that a particular company is dealing with, availability of the product, customer experience, order visibility and returnability. So, these are the elements of customer service influenced, whether we are reducing or increasing the response time. If you have a high variety of product, what should be our distribution network? On the other side, we also have to consider the cost that is affected by the network structure, by the distribution network structure. Inventories, is that particular distribution network designing increasing the inventory? If it is increasing the inventory, it is going to increase my cost. Is it going to increase the cost of transportation? Is it going to increase the cost of facility and handling and information? Vice versa, it may reduce, it may increase. So, we have to select the right distribution network design. So, what are the options we have with us? So, the first option direct shipping, which is experience, we experience this from Dell. What Dell does, Dell tries to reach out to its customer directly without involving anybody in between. So, all products of Dell are manufactured at their unit and they are delivered to the customer directly. So, that is first option of distribution, first option for a distribution network. Along with that, that means option number one, direct shipping, has certain cost factors. As for inventory, transportation, if you can see, inventory lower cost because of aggregation, low demand, high value. Transportation of high because of long distance. Just take one parameter. Since Dell have chosen the option number one of delivering directly to its customer, so obviously its transportation cost will be very high. Something which is manufactured or produced in Bangalore and a customer sitting in Guwahati, Dell will not use any intermediaries. They will not route it via distributor, retailer, you will not. So, he will use his own transportation, send it by FedEx or any particular carrier directly. So, obviously, they are going to incur additional cost. But that's their choice, because next slide tells you about the service factor. If you see the response time, product variety, they can easily provide high level of variety because they are directly, they are very close to the customer, they understand the need of the customer. And since the information are not received via media, retailers and wholesalers, they are in a position to provide more and more variety. We are not going to discuss this in detail for all the options. And as I repeat, when you get the study materials yourself, you will understand that on one side you have the metrics, on the service factor you have the response time, product variety, product availability, customer experience, order visibility, and on performance side, whether the performance is good or bad depends upon the option that a particular company selects as far as distribution network is concerned. Let's see the next option. So, the next option is manufacturer storage with direct shipping. Here the manufacturer will store, it is almost what Dell does, the manufacturer would store, there is a storage involved, the storing is done by the manufacturer and it is directly shipped to the customer. That is the second option. The second distribution network option, the first one was direct shipping, here the manufacturing is storing and it is shipped directly. Third, in transit merge by the carrier. On the right top, you have the company or the factory from where the shipments are produced and dispatched through a particular carrier. The carrier will not take it directly to the customer. They will merge, they will combine, consolidate in transit, in between, or en route to the customer. If you see in the middle, there are two small blue spots. On the right hand side is where they are merging, and from there at the bottom they are distributing to the customers. There are two types of flows, mind you, from the company to the customer. One is the product flow. That means when you talk of Dell or you talk of any other product, of course the product is moving, and what else is moving back? The information is moving back. Information on the delivery, information of the quality, information on the documentation, information, all possible information on that particular product delivery, that comes back through the retailer. Now, mind you, the carrier is not the retailer. There is a retailer who is responsible for transmitting. If you go back to the slide, you will see there are dotted lines. So, from the customer, the information go back to the retailer, and the retailer in turn gives a feedback to the company. So, this is third option. First was direct delivery, second was manufacturer storage and direct shipment, third is in transit merge or in transit consolidation by the carrier. Fourth is manufacturing storage with direct shipping and in transit merge. Here, the manufacturer of the product is storing. He is also, he is not involving any carrier, so that the customer gets a single delivery, the transportation cost is low, and the customer has a better experience because the manufacturer himself is directly shipping, but through an in-transit merge. He is also consolidating. So, this is another option. So, for you, it is important, more important to know these 5 or 6 options, okay, rather than going detailed into all these options or the descriptions. Let us see the fifth option. The fifth option is the shipment is sent to the distributor. The blue line shows you the movement of the product. There is a small blue circle in between. Who is the distributor? The distributor receives the shipment from the company, which is right at the top, and distributor in turn delivers it to the customers, which are right at the bottom. And it is the responsibility of the distributor to transmit the information, which is the red dotted line, back to the customer. So, there is a product flow, there is an information flow, and this is done in the fifth option by a distributor. Distributor with store and distributor use a carrier delivery. They do not deliver it themselves. Generally, distributors or the retailers do not undertake deliveries themselves. They will always use a delivery agent, or they will always use a carrier to deliver. Now, let us see the sixth option. So, here also there are certain cost factors. The parameters remain the same. As far as cost is concerned, there is inventory cost, transportation cost, facility and handling cost, and information cost. So, for all the options, sometimes the inventory cost is high, for some option the inventory cost is low. For some option the transportation cost is high. If you see, if you remember, for Dell the transportation cost was high, but in case of distributor storage with carrier delivery, the transportation cost is low because they are merging. The shipment is coming to the distributors and delivered to the customer. Same with the service factor. Somewhere the response time is large. With Dell, the first option, the product variety was large. In this case, the product variety is much lesser. We have retailer, we can ignore this distributor retailer storage with carrier delivery. Distributor storage with last mile delivery. Now, what is last mile delivery? You have to understand there is a difference. In a last mile delivery, we spoke of in transit merge. So, here is the company who is producing the product. So, they are consolidating, there is an in transit merge, and there are customers. In this case, shipment will be delivered directly to the customers. Now, all these options that we are talking of, what is the option, what is the distribution option that my company would take, depends upon what is the product I am, what is my product. Now, in last mile delivery, what happens? These are shipments which are generally lower in volumes. So, the company will not use so many carriers. The same carrier will deliver here. Suppose the shipment has arrived in Hyderabad, there are number of shipments. For number of customers, we have customer C1, C2, C3, C4. So, this was the distribution center. In earlier case, the distribution center would deliver to all these individual customers, but not here. The same carrier would deliver to C1, then he would deliver to C2, then he will deliver to C3 and C4 and go back to the distribution center. This is last mile delivery, where a proper routing is followed, is implemented or executed. So, same for this option also, we have cost and the service factor. though there is, this is another option, let us not discuss too much because it is still not implemented heavily in our country, where the customer would go to a particular retailer or a cross dock and pick up the shipments. Here if you see, the factories produce the product, they send the shipments to cross docks, cross docks do not store shipments, they straight away route the shipments to some pickup sites, the customer would come to the pickup site and they would pick up the shipments themselves, there would be no carrier delivering for them. This is definitely another option for distribution, but it is not exercised heavily or extensively in our country. As always, this option also has its own cost and service factors. We have a little bit, little portion of transportation left, but we have run out of time. We have about 10% of the transportation management still left, which I want to cover tomorrow. Tomorrow we again have two sessions the same time, and we are going to discuss a very important topic called inventory forecasting tomorrow, if I remember correctly. And we will utilize about 5 to 10 minutes to discuss. If you remember when we started transportation, I spoke about fleet management. So what is fleet management? How well fleet management is done today? What is the technology that's applied in fleet management? We'll just spend about 5 to 10 minutes. So what we have discussed today is transportation, the various modes, the comparison between the various modes, the cost factors, the different factors which influence the transportation cost. We have also discussed the distribution channel, the distribution channel between a particular company and its customer, how they move through the different distribution channel. And primarily we have three players in this distribution channel. One is the distributor, one is the retailer, and the carrier who is moving the shipment between the company to the distributor, to the retailer, to the consumer. And what distribution channel network, how many distribution network options we have discussed today? About 6 to 7. And whether a company would select or option number 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 depends upon what is his company policy, what is the kind of product he is making, what is the company for policy for Dell. They want to reach the customer directly, they want to meet the customer directly, they want to make sure that the customer response time, they hear from the customer about the product, they do not want to delay the product, they want to make any sort of modifications to whatever the customers require. So they are very, very, very customer centric. So they have selected option number 1. So there are companies who may use option number 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 depending upon the company vision, mission and the product. We come to the end of today's session. Thank you very much, and we meet again tomorrow, same time. Thank you very much.